हेलो, गुड इवनिंग एवरीबॉडी। माई सेल्फ डॉक्टर दिलीप पटवर्धन। लेट मी स्टार्ट विथ प्रेयर फ्रॉम जीवन विद्या मिशन। ओ गॉड, ब्लेस ऑल विथ हेल्थ एंड वेल्थ, ब्लेस ऑल मनी एंड हार्मनी। ओ गॉड, ब्लेस ऑल विथ पीस एंड ब्लीस, ब्लेस ऑल विथ विजडम एंड योर डिवोशन। टुडेज टॉपिक, एंजॉय स्ट्रेस। वन फील्स, हाउ कैन यू एंजॉय स्ट्रेस, इजंट इट? बट आई विल टेल यू हाउ टू एंजॉय स्ट्रेस टुडे। एवरीबडी इज स्ट्रेस्ड नाउ डेज एंड डिप्रेस्ड ऑल्सो, बट स्टिल वी आर वेल ड्रेस्ड, इजंट इट? आई ऑलवेज से दैट वी ऑल शुड नो द ABCD ऑफ लाइफ। Means what happens, we just go through the life. We should not go, we should grow through the life. And as I said, ABCD, B, birth, we don't have any control. Death, that also we don't have control. But in between there is C, there is choice to live, isn't it? So we are not born winners, neither losers, but we are choosers, isn't it? So I feel this stress is everywhere. There is nobody stressless. It can be divided into four parts: is physical, psychological, social, and emotional. Isn't it? See, it depends on the attitude towards the life that matters about the stress. Physical wise, I can say, you know the person Nicholas James from Australia. He was a tetraamelia patient, means both upper and lower limbs were not there, just a small stumps. Such a person in India will be lying on a wooden platform, somebody may be pulling and he will be begging, isn't it? But do you know that person can swim also and gives motivation lectures also? So this becomes the attitude towards. It is not what you have, it is what you do with what you have, isn't it? That's very important. I can tell you another example. Beethoven, you know, he was a composer of symphony. Ninth symphony was the best one. Was actually based on Ode to Joy, that sort of poem. But do you know, he could not listen to that symphony because he was deaf at that time. But still, see the attitude, positive attitude. Another person, John Milton, you know, a great poet who wrote a poem called Paradise Lost. I can tell you, he was blind at that time due to glaucoma. But still, the attitude, it made a difference. He did not went into depression, but he wrote the fantastic poem. In our India also, you know the example of Amitabh Bachchan. When he first approached All India Radio, he was rejected. For what? Because they say your voice quality is not good. But you know now, for last 5 decades, he is just the boss in film industry, isn't it? It depends on you. Even he thought of going into acting. Few said, you are so tall that you will be only useful to remove the webs. But the thing is different now, isn't it? So it depends on your attitude towards life. The stress is always there. It depends on how you look at it. If you think of psychological part of it, see, few people have got complaining attitude. Suppose you go to Chennai or go to Mumbai, and so in month of May you go and you say, oh, this time it is very, very hot. Last time it was good. Is it good last time? That time it was hot. But it's a complaining attitude. Increases your stress. How you look at it, you should always see, look at the brighter side of the life, isn't it? Another very important factor in our life is ego. Ego is very bad, you know. Nowadays there are nuclear families. I will tell you one story, because nowadays in nuclear family are very common. Both are working. How stress can be increased? There were one family, and that was Sunday morning, and they got sound on the outside door, and you know, in the morning you get paper, isn't it, newspaper. Both wanted to read it, so though both of went immediately to the door. Husband opened the door, and wife, she took the paper, the newspaper. You know, women are very intelligent, more than men. Men will not like it, but I will tell you, women are superior to men by nature. Funnily, I say the Greeks were already knowing it, because man is called male, isn't it? And female is called, woman is called female, isn't it? Epi means iron, you know. Nowadays, they iron man, iron man. The man is only man, but female is iron man, mind you. So she took the paper immediately. But as you know, our society is male dominant society. His ego was hurt. What he said? You give me that paper. She said, no, I have taken. I will read it first. I am telling you, these are the routine, you know, discussion in family. And she is not the old type of woman who will immediately submissive type, isn't it? She said, I have taken, I will give it. See, his voice again raised. Give me that paper, I will read it. Male dominance. She said, no, I have taken it first, I will read it first. Remember, I am telling this as a joke, but I will tell you, such a trivial reasons are there for divorces. You ask the lawyers, such a simple reasons which you laugh at. Then the person, the husband immediately got again said, if you don't give me that paper, she said, what you will do? What you will do? But I just funnily say that person had joined our Jivan Vidya Missions course, where we tell to suppress the ego. But still he tried again once. What he said? If you don't give me that paper, she said, what you'll do? What he said, do you know? Okay, you read it and then give it to me. Stress gone. I will tell you, you know, woman, female has got typical tender heart. What happened actually? Do you know? She gave the paper also, as well as prepared pohe and tea, and created a joy. You should be able to suppress your ego. Then stress is gone. Nowadays, why nowadays? It is every time. There is always a generation gap, isn't it? I will tell you a story in my life. Nobody else, but it's my own experience. And there are, these things will happen in many families. You can relate it to that. It has happened in my case. I will tell you my position. My father was a teacher in college. And he was very strict teacher. And he never did tuitions to earn money. Sincerely did his service in Willingdon College. This happened about 15 years back. See, when I also have got a big hospital and this thing, my ego is also, well, having my ego. My father was that time 80 years old. I was around 50 years old. And we were discussing. And as you know, generation gap is there. And I'll tell you, the discussion started losing the level of discussion. And both of us immediately came to know it's not going on right way. Then immediately I just stopped. He also stopped speaking. I went to my bedroom. He went to his bedroom. That night I could not sleep. Just moving from this side to that side. My wife asked, why you are getting in problem? Was there any problem? But you know, male ego is there. I said, no, nothing. That is routine. She said, nothing doing. See, you can't keep any secret in front of your spouse. Because in front of spouse, I always say, you are really open in all sense, isn't it? She said, nothing doing. You are having some problem. Otherwise, normally, you just go on bed and start snoring. Then I admitted, see what has happened. There was a discussion and somehow that discussion went to bad level. And that is why I just can't sleep. You know, I took her advice. She gave a fantastic advice. So I always tell all the males, you take advice of your wife, you know. Because there are many things which you can learn from your wife. What she told me, okay, this has happened, doesn't matter. Now what you do, you write down your points which you feel they are absolutely correct. And everybody feels our points are correct, isn't it? Okay, I said, I went on writing, and I can tell you, writing is a complex process. Because if you're writing, that time, in case the wrong word is there, you can rub it off. But when you talk, you can't rub it out. You can't rub it out, isn't it? So, when I started writing, immediately I wrote down 1, 2, 3 points. 3 points I wrote down. And, but last fourth sentence I wrote was different. I said, I used to call my father as Baba, Baba, whatever happened was not a good thing. Please forgive me. I wrote down and my heart was very clear. All the weight on my chest was gone. I slept. Next day morning, I got up. And when I saw him, I had no guts to look at his eyes. I gave that chit to him. And I went to Operation Theater. And whole day I was busy. In the night at 9 o'clock, I came. My father was waiting for me. He was also a teacher and he was vice principal also of Wellington College. He had written 4 points. I had written 3 points, he had written 4 points. How he is right. And everybody feels one is right, isn't it? But I will tell you, there's a law of nature, action, reaction. My action was there. Do you know what happened? I can't forget that incident still. At the age of 80, and a teacher always has got habit of only teaching and telling others, isn't it? Not listening. Two-way track is not there usually, isn't it? You know, he wrote down the 4 points, but he wrote down one more sentence. He said, yes, Dilip, whatever happened was not good. Please forgive me. Can you imagine? At the age of 80, he wrote that. And I can tell you, he lived about 8 years after that. But then really, I got connected to him. Till that time, I was in contact, but not connected. I will tell you, in our family, many times, we are in contact, but not connected. Those 8 years were just fantastic. I think that you can relate it to yourself. So writing down is the best solution. And when it, don't react. Suddenly, if you react, it is usually not logical. Sometimes, see, words, once you utter, you cannot take it back. Writing is the best policy. Once you, there is action, don't react, you respond. I will tell you a funny story about that. There was one person was climbing. It was a 6-7 stories building and the lift was not working. He was climbing, went up to last floor, upper floor, and tapped on the door, which was closed. He said, Sharmaji, your daughter has gone with that vagabond boy staying nearby. Ran away with him. You can imagine what must have happened in the brain of that father inside. He was totally, absolutely disturbed. Then he started thinking, how can I face the people? She has literally done a very bad thing and I am absolutely, I can't face the people. And the door was open, there was gallery. He just thought of committing suicide. You know, he jumped from that floor. When he was coming down, when he was on fourth floor, he realized that he doesn't have a daughter. See, when you react suddenly, it becomes illogical. Always remember, think first and you should respond all the time. Never react. Another point about ego, you know, I will tell you one more story. One crow was there putting a piece of meat in his mouth and was just flying and many birds started chasing him like anything. Then he started going up in the sky. But other birds will not leave him. They started chasing. When he just got, you know, exhausted, he came to know that these birds are not after me, but they are after this piece of meat, isn't it? So he left that piece of meat down. Naturally, all birds went towards this piece of meat. And do you know, he was totally freed. He was absolutely nicely moving in the sky, very freedom, and mind became very clear. He was, stress had gone. I always relate that piece of meat as an ego. If you leave the ego, then the life becomes very easy, very nice, isn't it? So I always feel another thing, we make mistake. And to err is human, isn't it? We do mistakes. But people continuously feel very guilty about what mistake they have done. You should never feel. To err is a normal thing, and don't feel guilty about our mistakes. You can definitely improve on that, but don't feel guilty. That is also one of the cause of tremendous stress. People are feel very guilty. And I had been to one executive director. On his table it was written, "These days will also go." And present situation is like that, isn't it? We are all stressed because of that coronavirus, but always remember, these days also will go. This attitude should be in your brain. Another problem with people is that we don't remain in present. We don't live now. Either we are thinking of past, that also bad things. Suppose your one of friend is there who has helped you 7, 8 times, but once because of some misunderstanding there was some problem, you will remember only the bad thing of the past. So I always say, past gives you tears and future gives you fear. Do you know what is the full form of fear? Fear means false estimate of actual reality. There is always a sentence, no? The devil in us terrorizes is painted. Remember that. So don't worry about the future. Don't think of past. We remain in present. That is why present is called gift, isn't it? I can tell you, I really happen to have a very good example of living now. My granddaughter is there. Her name is Swara. I had been to Mumbai and I just called her. "What are you doing?" Naturally, I was expecting that she will tell, "I am playing," or, "I am eating," something like that, isn't it? The answer she gave was a brilliant answer, I can tell you. That is why all the kids are very happy, you know. They are happy like that because they don't have much past and they're not worried about the future. They are just in present. Do you know the answer what my granddaughter Swara gave? She said, "Abba, I am talking to you on phone." Really, she was living now. We should always try to live in now. What happens? We are continuously, even if you are drinking tea, you are watching TV. Why? Enjoy the tea. Enjoy the flavor of the tea. We don't do that, isn't it? I will tell you, there was one person who came from Madurai to Bombay. On the airport, he got down and he wanted to meet his relatives. So he called a taxi. Went in taxi, told the taxi the address of his relative, and the taxi was going very nicely. And he suddenly realized, I am going to my relative after such a long time, I should carry some sweets, isn't it? So what he did, because taxi driver was going very nicely, he tapped on the shoulder of that taxi driver to keep his attention and told him, "Once you see a sweet shop, just take the taxi by the side, I will bring the sweets and then we'll go ahead." Do you know what happened? A very funny thing happened. That taxi driver started, you know, trembling in terror, started sweating. That person really got felt very guilt that, "Oh, unnecessarily I have disturbed him when he was driving very nicely." So he said, "I am very sorry I disturbed you while driving." Whether he thought that whether he's getting heart attack or what. But the driver said, "Do you know? No, mister, that is not your fault. Don't worry, it is not your fault." And do you know what happened? He tried to, it is said, steering wheel was moving here and there. By effort, she came down and just stopped the car just by the side of road. And that he was very guilty that he disturbed the driver. Driver said, "That is not your fault." Then he said, "What happened?" He told the story that, "See, yesterday, till yesterday, last 20 years, I am driving a big lorry. Today only I am driving a taxi." But then he said, "Well, you are driving quite okay, and what is the difference between driving a lorry and car? You are driving quite well." No, that is not your fault. It is my fault only." "Why? What is the fault then? What happened?" Then he explained what he said. Till yesterday, I was carrying only dead bodies in that lorry. Now you can imagine somebody putting hand on the shoulder because he was in past. He was not in future, not in present. That is what happened. We continuously think of past and those dead bodies, the dead things, you continuously remind and spoil your now. Don't you think it's correct? So always remember, remain in this now. Then you will not get pardoned. And what is after all stress? Stress is nothing but expectation minus ability. A very simple equation. If your expectations are very high, ability is not that much, equation is wrong, stress will be more. So either increase your ability or reduce your expectations. Isn't it? Very simple formula. That's always you should remember. Now, people say stress is bad, but no. There is something like eustress. Some stress is needed. You know what happens? There is some stress, your efficiency goes up. A simple example I can tell you, if you have got a rubber, unless until you stretch, there will not be any potential energy, isn't it? Why? You take a bow, put a string on that. Unless and until you put that string and attach bow to it, it cannot shoot, isn't it? Shoot the bow. Simple. So some stress is must. Especially in India, it is a must when you are driving, isn't it? In Western country, it's freeways, nobody comes from front. In India, if you are so much relaxed while driving, what will happen? Not only people come forward, but there are cows, buffaloes, dogs, isn't it? So some stress and some attention is a must. What are the different ways to contract this thing? We know yoga is very well accepted. People call yoga. It is not yoga. It is yoga. Comes from original word, principle, that is yoga. Means yuja. Yuja is the Sanskrit word. When mind, body and cosmic life force work in unison, it is called yoga. It is not those asanas done by Ramdev. That is called Hatha yoga. That is also good for physical strain. But the yoga is this. When mind, body and cosmic life force are unison. And frankly speaking, people do meditation. Actually, meditation is not to be done. It happens. Because suppose now I am an ophthalmologist. If I start operating cataract, my total concentration is an operation. When my mind, body and cosmic life force working together, I am meditating. Anybody doing his job with full heart in that, is meditating. You don't have to do meditation. What happens? People say, hey, they will go in one isolated room, keep the eyes closed, see that no sound comes, keep the mouth shut and everything. Sorry, if you do that, just imagine when you close your eyes and sit quietly alone, many bad negative thinking will be more prevalent when you do that. Simple. If I tell you, for 15 seconds, you shut your eyes, keep everything, don't talk anything, and don't think of monkey. What will happen? You will be thinking of monkey only, isn't it? So meditation is not to be done, mind you. It should happen. Whatever job you do, do with full heart in it, full mind in it, everything. You are meditating, and meditation is very important, I tell you. It is proved now, you know, it is proved nowadays, especially about this coronavirus, people talk about body treatment, isn't it? They talk about drugs, they talk about, you know, vaccines and this thing. Yes, that is absolutely correct. Social distancing, absolutely correct. But we can't treat body alone. Body is not alone. It is along with mind, isn't it? Mind has to be treated, no? And I will tell you, scientifically it is proved. The meditation can impact the gene expression. It reduces the vulnerability towards the disease. Lifestyle factors can affect the length of the telomeres of the genes. I will explain that. Nobel Prize winner Elizabeth Blackburn and health psychologist Eliza Appel explain that negative thoughts affect the length of the telomeres. And more the length of telomeres, more you live. Do you know that? So immunity increases with the positive thoughts and it decreases with negative thoughts. So do you know what to do for that? In the beginning, I uttered one prarthana, one prayer, isn't it? What was that? Oh God, bless all with health and wealth. Bless all with money and harmony. Oh God, bless all with peace and bliss. And bless all with wisdom and your devotion. Simple. It contains only positive vibrations. If all of us utter this prayer now, even now, this vibration will reach all the earth. Sometimes one may feel, how can it reach? Yes, it can reach. Now I am talking to you. My friend in California, if catches my frequency on mobile, it reaches there. When my simple gross speaking reaches all over the world, all over the earth is revolving round, then why not our prayer also? Especially if we do it together, collective consciousness or collective mind is extremely powerful, I can tell you. That will increase the immunity of everybody, mind you. Simple thing, I always say, chant this prayer, any positive prayer. This is the prayer which Jivan Vidya gave me, but you can have any positive. We have got very good survey in a Sikhi. Isn't it that Sanskrit prayer? You can do that. But do it collectively, it will give best result. It will increase your immunity and it is scientifically proved, mind you. Okay, so this thing we can do. What else you can do? Sports. No, sports, exercise. That also elates you, your stress goes down. Whenever there is mental stress, do a lot of physical exercise. You'll say, why? Again, I will tell you scientific reason. When you do exercise or do sports, do you know, endorphins are released in the body. That uplifts your mood. If you achieve something, then the dopamine also is released. That uplifts your mood, you know. Stress goes down. Whenever you are stressed, go in gym. Start doing physical exercise. Yes, it is proved that endorphins are released and all the, you can do anything, sports, because sports you are interested, no? You enjoy that, you will never get tired. Whatever you are interested in, whatever you love, if you do that, you will never get stressed. Isn't it? Whatever you don't like, suppose you go to office, see you get tired because you don't feel like working there. But same thing, you know, when kids you can see, you tell them to study, they will get tired. But the same time you allow them to play in the, you know, sunlight cricket, oh, they will play for 3 hours but will not get tired. Because it's what you love, if you do, you will never get tired and never stressed. Isn't it? So always remember, you do whatever you do, love that work. I always say, love work and bless all. That is the best. Now, our Jivan Vidya tackles it in different way. Stress is tackled in very different way. We always say, see, I just talk to many people at any age and I just ask them one question. Can you tell me what is the purpose of your life? People go on telling many theoretical things. Like, I want to have a moksha. I want to get a sakshatkar. I want to know the Parmeshwar and God and everything. All these are theoretical things. They don't know what is God. But they just, because they are in the kids, when they are kids, they are seen in films that some God comes and says, whatever you want, I will give you four hands. And they all imaginary things. They don't know. I will tell you one story. There was a class of 8th class students. And their teacher gave them assignment. And she said, okay, I will give you assignment. Write down your answer with explanation. And what she gave assignment, she told the students, tell me what you want to achieve in life. What you want to get in life. Okay. Many students went on writing. One wrote that, I want to be chartered accountant. Somebody said, I want to be doctor. Somebody said, I want to be engineer and whatnot and whatnot. But one student was scratching his head and everybody was writing, giving the chit to the teacher and going out of the class. That fellow scratching it, then he just struck some idea. He wrote down something, gave the chit to the teacher and was going out. He was the last one. She just read it and called him, hey, come in, come in. I think you have not understood the meaning of assignment. You have not, what you have written, see, everybody has written, somebody has written doctor, engineer, chartered accountant, everything. And what you have written, do you know what he had written? He had written, I want to be happy. I want to get happiness in life. So you have not understood the assignment, write down again. Do you know what that student answered? He said, madam, I misunderstood the assignment, but you misunderstood life. isn't it? Ultimately, everybody may be doing any job. What do you want actually in life? Happiness, not God. Nobody wants God. Just hypothetically, just suppose there is one pot in which God is kept, and other pot, they are kept happiness, pleasure in that, and told people, okay, have a queue. It's freely available. Where will be the queue? Towards the God? Nobody will go to God. Everybody wants happiness, isn't it? And God also, why they want? They want happiness. Ultimately, happiness is the thing. Then jeevan vidya thinks in different way. How can you get happiness? Is there happiness? Is there a joy? Jeevan vidya depends on the laws of nature. Action reaction is extremely important. You have to act. Then you get reaction. Law of nature, which has got no exception. So if you want joy, you have to give it to others. Then only you will get it. If you have to scratch the joy, you will never get. You have to first give it, then you get in return. Very simple, very simple. But then people ask, oh, we don't have ourselves joy. How can I give? Whatever you have, that only you give, no? No. Our Indian culture has proved that joy is within, not outside. The very problem is that you try to search joy outside, so it is the wrong direction. There are many directions to different roads on the earth, but for our consciousness, there is only one road. It has got two directions. One is outside and one is inside. You try to search joy outside, whereas the joy is inside. So you go the wrong direction and you go into misery. Then you will say, how can you prove? Yes, jivan vidya proves everything scientifically. Joy is inside, Satchidananda. How can you prove? I will tell you the three different things that will prove that joy is inside. Okay? Now, just watch a kid of 8 months, 9 months, small kid. As a doctor, I can tell you, it smiles, laughs, or moves his hands like this at least 200 to 250 times in a day. Have you not observed it? Laughs without any reason. Why? There should be reason, no? Cause and effect, law of cause and effect. Why? The reason is that the joy is, you know, like a fountain of joy. It just comes out like a fountain of joy. So it is expressed in your face by smiling, laughing, or moving hands. Simple, no? Suppose you get a lottery of 10 lakhs. Will you sit quietly and say, I got lottery of 10 lakhs? No, you will shout, you will enjoy, you will dance. Simple. So this is the way child expresses through smile, isn't it? Simple. Nobody tells him joke, isn't it? One thing. So that is proved that inside. Another reason I will tell you how the joy is inside. I will prove that. Suppose nowadays people, everybody goes for a walk. Nowadays there are many gardens in Sangli also. People go in the morning. What they do? They come together and there is laughter clubs nowadays. Isn't it? That's a good thing. Laughter clubs are there too. Even laughing also increases endorphin when you laugh. Yes. The laughter club is there. Suppose you are not in that group. You are just standing 20 feet away from that group. And they start laughing. They start laughing. You also start laughing, isn't it? Why? Because that laughter club, laughing is a natural process. It stimulates your inner joy and then you start laughing. Exactly. You just see, suppose there are four ladies in some corner of a hall, they are crying. Do you cry? Never. Because crying is not normal. Laughing, joy is a normal thing. When the joy is stimulated inside, you stop. So, proved second time. I will tell you third example. Sometimes you may say, okay, I will go and attend a nice musical concert. I get happiness. Correct. You do get happiness. That is correct. You listen to a nice song, you get happiness. Very true. You get happiness. You see a very nice movie. Yes, you get happiness. But once the movie is over, the joy is over. Once the concert is over, joy is over. So that Vishyananda we call is only for a temporary period. It's not eternal, isn't it? And you feel that there is a joy in the song. There is a joy in the movie. No, it is not in that. I will prove that. Suppose, just think hypothetically, you won some prize and they told that nowadays a very famous singer is there. What is that? Neeta Kakkar or somebody. She is there, no? She sings nicely. And suppose you are given an award that she will come to your house with orchestra and sing the song which you like most. Great, na? Idea? Why not? Why not to think? Isn't it? Okay, she comes and sings a very favorite song. You get great joy, isn't it? You will get, yes, you are joyful. Okay, she sings the same song again twice. Your joy becomes half, isn't it? If she sings the same song for 5 times, what you will say? Madam, I got job to do, please. Namaskar. That means Neeta Kakkar's song didn't have that joy. When she sang for the first time, that stimulated the inner joy inside you. That the fountain of joy got stimulated, then you got happiness. You experienced the joy within, then you got happy. But when she started singing, that could not stimulate the inner joy. So you could not experience the joy. Are you getting it? Am I absolutely clear that joy is inside? So don't search outside. It is very much here, nowhere else. Now you are sure that you have got joy with you. That means you can give it to others. So unless and you give it to others, you won't get it. Simple equation. When I say you have to give it, means everybody tries to just locate where the pocket is there. Why? Because money, they are related to the joy. Wrong. Money can give you physical comforts. Yes. But joy, sorry. No way. Money cannot give you joy. Okay. Now, what are the things you can give and get joy? Our Sadhguru is Vaman Rao Pai. He just funnily used to say, my name is Pai. But whatever the solutions I tell doesn't require a single Pai. I will go on telling you. Tell you the different things which you don't have to spend a single Pai. Okay. Now, one simple thing you can do, you can smile, no? You can smile. It requires nothing. Isn't it? Smile. Do this smile in the morning. Just see people go for a walk. How is the face? As if they have taken castor oil in a night, isn't it? Why? As if there is low total tension of India is on their head, isn't it? No. Simple smile in Western country, if you go, even if you don't know the person, he will say, good morning. What is the harm in that? Do you have to spend? Smile is a simple thing. Do you know how the smile word has come? Smile means satisfied mind in lip expression is smile. Simple. And it requires very less muscles, less calories. If you frown like this, it requires more muscles and more calories. So it is very easy to smile, isn't it? You can smile. Okay. Suppose the person is going with a face like this. But suppose some acquaintance, some friend of him is coming from forwards. Yes, then he will definitely smile. No doubt. But do you know what he asks that person? What is the way conversation goes on? Once that person comes in, he will smile and ask, how much is your sugar? How much is your BP? Is it distributing joy? And suppose he says, oh, mine is 400. And suppose you have got only 150. Then you will get joy. Para dukkha shitalam. So this is not distributing joy, isn't it? It is distributing grief. So never say it like that. See, in India, it is usual find. You find this. Suppose somebody asks you, how is the life going on? Going on. Such a miserable place. Why? I don't know what is going to happen tomorrow. Are why? Enjoy now. You at least say at least. In India, they always say, whatever you say, the supernatural power or life force says, tathastu. Tathas means, the way you are saying, the same you will have. As you think, so you become. Isn't it? So smile is a simple thing. Will you do from tomorrow? Do it. And you will get a great joy. You will get many friends also. Simple smile you can do, isn't it? What other thing you can do? You can praise a person, appreciate a person. Correct appreciation, not wrong way. You can appreciate a person. Appreciation everybody likes, isn't it? Even God also likes appreciation. You know, people do aarti. Aarti means what? That is nothing but appreciation of praising a God. That God also likes. You know, why can't you like? And you know, in our India, why India? I think everywhere, they do housewarming ceremony, isn't it? In our language, we call Vastu Shant, isn't it? Actually, Vastu is always Shant. The people inside are not Shant. Isn't it? What they do, suppose they have got a very nice home, they have got a lot of interior done and everything, so many things done, but nobody visits. There is no fun, no, unless it is gets appreciation from others. That is why they call all the people and do Vastu Shastra. Especially ladies, you know what happens? If her friend comes, she will take her to kitchen and show. See, if this drawer is meant for big spoons, this one is for small spoons. You know, you can see that wooden plate. Once it is like this, it becomes a table. When it goes like this, it becomes a mirror. When the guest starts showing signs of appreciation on face, oh, then the host becomes damn happy, isn't it? Don't you? And even the guest asks, "Are what is that door for?" Then she will tell, "Oh, that is the innovation I have done. Why? That door is for a storage room. Suppose I am doing some kitchen, handling the kitchen and doing some this thing, preparing some food, and something is missing, then I can immediately take the thing from that store. So it becomes easy." Such a fantastic ideas she has done, and appreciation is there. Once you appreciate, then she will tell, "Okay, now you can go and have a dinner." Till that time, she will not serve you a dinner, mind you. So I funnily say, if you want to have immediately dinner, you want to go for your work, start praising. Whenever you go in there, start praising. You will get immediately dinner, just for fun. So this is the thing. What else you can do? You can give respect. You can give respect to everybody. Everybody. That also gives great pleasure. I will tell you one story again. There was a cold storage, and there was some problem in the electrical problem in that storage. So many engineers used to come at 11 o'clock. That cold storage used to get open, and at 5 o'clock it used to get closed. That engineers used to come do the repair work, but could not complete in a day. Again, go back, again come next day. One day, what happened? One engineer was inside. He was so much engrossed in repairing that work, and he forgot that 5 o'clock already was over. And when he started coming out, watchman closed the door. At 5 o'clock, he closes the door, and next day, 11 o'clock, he will come. Oh my God, he started trembling in terror, just went, tried to tap on the door. Nobody was there. Started shouting, "It's a soundproof." So he realized that now his last day has come. Very much afraid, he just sat there, absolute trembling, and it was chilling, it was going to minus 10 degrees. And suddenly, after 15 minutes, the door opened. Oh my, he came out absolutely with lot of efforts. Just he came to his senses and he said, "Oh, you are God for me. Unless and you had not opened the door, I would have died." When he came to senses, he just asked the watchman, "Are, you should have opened it next day morning, 11 o'clock. Why did you open now? What made you open?" The answer given by watchman, you just remember. You'll know, don't forget that. Do you know what answer he said? "See, there are many engineers come and go, but you are the only one who inquires about my health. When you come, you will talk to me and then go inside. And when you finish the work, when you go, that time also you inquire how was the day and everything. You talk to me, you give me respect, and you go. But today, I felt that engineer who always inquires, I couldn't remember. So just to confirm, I opened the door." Remember, you don't know who can help you. Anybody will be very help. So respect everybody. In Marathi, we call कोण कोणाला कधी कुठे केव्हा कसा उपयोगी पडेल हे ब्रह्मदेवसुद्धा सांगू शकत नाही. म्हणून सगळ्यांची रिलेशन चांगली ठेवण्यात खरं शहाणपण आहे. गॉट इट? यू शुड हॅव ऑलवेज गुड रिलेशन्स विथ एव्हरीबडी. यू डोंट नो हू इज गोइंग टू हेल्प यू इन फ्युचर. ओके, नाव अबाउट द ऑलमोस्ट इज गोइंग टू 10 o'clock. आय थिंक दॅट टायमिंग इज ओवर. इज इट? शुड आय स्टॉप और कंटिन्यू फॉर 10 मिनिट्स मोर? प्लीज यू कॅन गिव्ह मी मेसेज. Okay, I will just talk for 10 minutes and we'll stop. Almost it is 10 o'clock. I can see that watch. Okay. There is something like Vedic wisdom. You remember that. When you accept uncertainty, at present the same situation is there, isn't it? You don't know when you are going to be really free from lockdown, free from that virus, everything. When you accept uncertainty, it becomes adventure. Got it? When you accept uncertainty, it becomes adventure. If you don't accept, then you get fear, isn't it? I will tell the example. Suppose you are climbing and you are a regular climber of hill climbing you are doing. And you know, when you go, the people go to Everest, they know that people die. There is avalanche, there is landslide, but then that is an adventure for them. But suppose another person, you just lift him with a helicopter, keep it on 20,000 feet above. Oh, he will start, because he has not accepted it, got it? So once you accept uncertainty, these are the days you accept the uncertainty, it becomes adventure. Yes, your approach will become adventure. What is another Vedic wisdom? When you accept the things which are beyond your control, it gives you tolerance. If you don't accept, you will become angry. Is there a point in becoming angry against virus? Not at all. Accept, because that is not under your control. Accept, then it gives tolerance. Vedic wisdom, I can tell you, that they have taken into consideration so many points. And it really fits now, isn't it? Accept the things which you don't have any control, then you get tolerance. If you don't accept, you will get anger. Thirdly, when you accept good in others, you get inspiration. You can learn from him, but you have to accept first, isn't it? Once you accept good in others, you get inspiration. If you don't accept, then what happens? You will be absolutely, you know, envious about him, isn't it? You will get envious. You will get, you know, not happy with it, and envy, you will envy him. So that is wrong. Now, what is the fourth thing? If you accept as it is, a person as it is, especially that is important when husband and wife are there. You accept the person as it is with good and bad points, then you get love. Then you love that person. If you don't accept, then you start hating. Isn't that? So especially for husband and wife, I can tell you, nobody is perfect in this world. You accept the good points and bad points of your spouse, then life becomes great. You know, life becomes great. Because nobody is perfect in this world. So if you want to love your spouse, accept good and bad points both. This is Vedic wisdom. They always say, be strong but not rude. What they say? Be strong but not rude. Be kind. Be kind but not weak. See, our wisdom is so tell. Be kind but not weak. Be humble. Be humble but not timid. Are you getting it? Be humble but not timid, mind you, not timid. And be proud. You know, proud. We should be proud, no doubt. Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj, see his statue. Proud, but not arrogant. There is a difference between two, isn't it? Be proud but not arrogant. Proud means it is absolutely okay. Everyone has to be proud of many things, but never be arrogant. That will create a big problem. Now, I will tell you something about our prayer. And people don't know the exact concept. Conceptual problem is there. People don't know what target is there. And then success becomes a failure. I will tell you one more story. There were four scientists working on some invention was going on. They were tremendously engrossed in that. And they wanted to present a paper in another town. They were in Mumbai. So they went on a station, VT station, from where the train starts. And there was time for the train timing was slightly 15 minutes after that, almost half an hour after that. So what they did, they kept the luggage inside the bogey, went on the platform and started discussing about their invention. They were so much engrossed that the whistle, they could not listen. And the train started, they could not listen to that whistle. And when the last bogey was going, one of the scientists realized, "Oh, the train has already started." They started running like a mad to catch the train, because otherwise they have missed, no? They were supposed to present a paper in another town. They started running out of that. One was absolutely slightly aged, three were slightly younger. They ran, and the three of them could climb the train. They could climb the train. And you know, once you achieved something, what you do? Yeah, they did yeah. Means that sign of achievement. So they were successful, isn't it? Catching the train. But the fourth one, you know, was very sad. He came and sat on the bench on the platform. He was very sad. The train already had gone again. Then another passenger was there. He just said, "Why you are so sad?" He said, "See, I was supposed to go and present the paper, but I just missed the train." That passenger said, "Which town you wanted to go?" "This town." "Oh, don't worry. After 1 hour, there is a train going to same spot, same spot." Okay. So he said, but still he was not happy. "No, no, no. What had happened was not good." "Are, what happened?" "After just, I can tell you, after just maybe half an hour, you will catch the train and go to the same spot." "No, no, the problem is different. Actually, I was supposed to present the paper and those three scientists had come to see me off." So you can realize what they thought was success was a failure, isn't it? Because they never knew the target. This is what happens in life. You should know what is exact. Your conceptual clarity has to be there. I will tell you one very nice concept which very few people really know. The prosperity and money rich. These two things are different. I can tell you this totally. Because our Marathi Prarthana is like that. "Hey Ishwara, sarvanna changli buddhi de, arogya de. Sarvanna sukhat, anandat, aishwaryat thev. Sarvansa bhalakar, kalyankar, rakshankar. Ani tujha god naam, mukhat akhanda rahude." Aishwarya means prosperity. We are asked for prosperity. Not poverty, mind you. Not at all. Aishwarya. What happened? I actually came to Rotary Club just 6 years back, because till that time I was practicing. I was very busy from morning 7 o'clock to night 11:30. I was very busy. But then my son, who is also ophthalmologist, luckily he is a gold medalist from AIIMS, by the way, he has taken over now. And now once he has joined, one of my friends said, "Now you can come in Rotary, you can do some social work." I said, "Okay, now I got time, I will join." And we Rotarians know, any new person comes, "Know your Rotarian" is the program, isn't it? People ask them to introduce other Rotarians because others may not know. But funnily, in that Rotary Club, I had already many friends. They were either my patients or my friends. Because those who were already rich, like fewer industrialists, fewer businessmen and all those things, they were already in Rotary because they had money. When I started my practice, it was as I told, my father was teacher and there was no great payment that time. I started with a very low, you know, profile. And they knew, now I got a big bungalow and all this thing, everything there. So when my interview was to be taken, all my friends, they called their next generation. Why? They wanted to give inspiration to them that how this my friend who came from absolutely lower middle class, now he has reached such a stage by honest hard work. You can do that. So they get inspiration. That is why hall was full. And my interview started. The person, the other Rotarian, I think it was Dr. Abhijit Udgaonkar, who was taking my interview. And he asked me, "You tell us about your life, how you grew." And there was a chance, no, to get, you know, praise. And I could have told, I had no money. I had to sit on the road and on the lamp of that road and sort of that thing. No, I said, no, nothing doing. My father was earning that much. Two times lunch was okay and I was otherwise okay. There was no great problem. But I told them one sentence which nobody accepted. You know, I said, I was born in prosperous family. I was born in prosperous family. Oh, everybody was skeptical. My friends were in they're listening. I said, "Don't tell me, Dilip. I have seen you where you used to stay. And you are telling you are come from prosperous family?" I said, "Yes, I will prove that." I will tell you. Because the concepts people don't know. Do you know what I told them? How my family was prosperous? I told them, "I will tell you a few things. You tell me whether they come in prosperity or not." I said, "I got very good parents who gave me great education, great sanskar." Isn't it? Is it not important? Yes. My father was a teacher, never took tuitions to earn extra money. He very honestly taught in the college. That's all. That is why he used to go on cycle till he got retired. He never... I just, sorry, there was a phone call. Okay, I told them, is it not important? Secondly, I had a very good neighbors. Now also I have got good neighbor. I used to get very good appetite. Now also I good appetite. I used to get very good sleep. Now also I get very good sleep. My wife is excellent. She is very good. My both sons are very good. Now you tell me, all these things, are they not important? They are important. But remember, all these things you cannot purchase by money. Challenge, you cannot purchase. About your parents, you don't have choice. I call Purva Sanchit. But your neighbors, you just find people have got always fight with neighbors. Then you don't have prosperity. For that, you have to do sacrifice for the neighbor. Then the neighbor becomes good. Your neighbor cannot become just like that good. You have to sacrifice. Isn't it? Secondly, you get good appetite and good sleep when? When you work honestly. When you work honestly, then only you get very good sleep and very good. Okay? Agreed? You cannot get your wife or husband good one. Why? For that, you have to give respect to your spouse. Then only life becomes easy and then only you get prosperity. You cannot purchase your wife or husband. No, no money can give you good wife or husband, isn't it? So you cannot purchase. Your sons, my both sons, I will tell you, I practiced in slum area for 17 years. My both sons were just, one was 5 year old, one was 1 year old. All my friends said, oh, you have chosen a wrong place. You are working in slum area. Your sons will get spoiled. They will not get good samskar. I said, nothing doing. Forget about my sons, but I can tell you, the students in that Jhopadpatti slum, they will improve. I am very happy to tell you because my father was teacher, no? I was busy, but my father was retired, so he was teacher. He collected the kids who were of the age of my sons and tried to teach them, give them good samskar. Of course, not everybody learned, but I got two examples to tell you with the name. One is Sudarshan Kamble. He has become lawyer and will be becoming judge in the recent future. Another is Suresh, who has become English teacher. Yes. And my both sons are gold medalists. Take it from me. My elder son, who is now practicing, that is why I am free and doing Jeevan Vidya job, Jeevan Vidya work, karya. He is a gold medalist from AIIMS. Another son is engineer. He has done MBA from, he was in McKinsey. Hello. Because